good.
It does look pretty good.
Yeah, this looks good. This is pretty much what I did, you know, the second, third, and fourth day of this tournament, fishing up this river. I was looking for banks. You know, I know pretty much all the places that I fished them in the past, but I was looking for a certain type of bank that had some rock. You couldn't just fish the gravel. It had to have some of the rock mixed with some wood. If it had wood on it and the big chunk rock, or the bluffy style rocks, anywhere that transition was good this week for sure.
All right, the day after the tournament here on Beaver Lake, we're with the champ, Scott Canterbury, Quaker State Pro, and he's gonna show us, you know, the little ins and outs of what he did to win this tournament. It wasn't necessarily like a spot specific thing, so we're gonna run around, he's gonna show us the banks he was looking for, he's gonna show us the setup he used, and we're just gonna have a good time out here fishing and maybe catch us a couple, right?
Yeah, I hope we get a couple of bites. You know, I've been able to get several bites every day, and maybe we'll be able to show everybody how I've been doing it.
I like it. So we just pulled into this bank. And
yeah.
Why'd we stop here? What'd you like about it?
You know, I mean, it's got those steep bank. It's the steep sides on it. And you know, after the first day of the tournament, I did fish down the lake a lot and ended up the second, third, and fourth day of the tournament coming up and fishing the river section. And, you know, making that decision wasn't that there was more fish up the river. It's the biggest thing is everybody in the tournament knew there's a bite right there. Did you get a bite? I mean, everybody in the tournament knew. I've never been in this pocket. But everybody in the tournament also knew that every big tournament all spring and winter had been won down the lake. So that's where everybody was at.
Mm-hmm.
And that was one of my, I mean, it was like playing musical chairs down there.
It was crowded.
It was very crowded in the area that I went to the first day. And the fish that I'm catching, I mean, just like that one. I mean,
yep.
You don't have to talk them into eating. I mean, when you get around one right now, I mean, they're eating. Half the fish that I caught had big crawfish pinchers in their throat. So, I mean, they're eating, and they're not eating just because they're hungry. I mean, they're just continuously eating.
Right.
They're on that feed bag getting ready to spawn, and that's why they're on that wood up here. Right before they always spawn, they usually get on wood pretty hard. And that worked out to my favor this week because I love fishing wood.
It was a very Scott Canterbury kind of style. And
yeah.
I mean, really the tackle you were using too, it's not normal Beaver Lake, if you know we want to put it that way.
No, it's not normal Beaver Lake. I mean, you know, on this rod here, it's a 7.6 heavy Twilight series, but I've got 15 pound P-line on it. And that's that compact jig that I started the tournament out with. This rod, I got 20-pound P-line, and then I rigged one up with a 5/8 jig on it with 25. So, I mean, it's nothing like we usually use on beaver.
No.
I caught one fish off the bed that I actually sight fish for this week, and, I mean, they were eating so good that it didn't matter what you use. So, I mean, I caught it on 65-pound braid on the first pitch. If you found those ones that were just moving up, now there's some on that lower end that people really messed with, and they'd been there a couple of days, and you just couldn't catch them. They couldn't catch them, yeah. And that really played to help me out, too. There's so many boats down there. I mean, you know, the last day of practice, there's 20% of the lake clear down there, and I think 70% of the boats was in that 20% of the lake.
Yeah, they were.
And I made my mind up right then that I wasn't going down there. I mean, I went down there and looked that last day. I spent half the day down there looking.
Now the water color, like obviously it was dirtier this time around, but up the river, it cleared up a lot each day of the tournament. And you had a cool story about when you practiced in War Eagle,
yeah.
How it was real dirty.
Yeah, you know, the first day we got here, I fished up the river and went into War Eagle, and the water was dirty. And we got a couple of bites, you know, and we didn't just catch them really good, but I caught one, you know, 3-pounder or so. And I know that area of the lake really, really well. Mm-hmm. That area of the river, put it that way. I know it really well, better than I do anything else. So the next day or two, we spent down the lake, and I didn't go back up to War Eagle until after lunch, the first day of the tournament. And I get back up there and the water's all clear, a lot clearer than it was when we was up there. And I was able to upgrade that day. Just, I think I culled one fish up there that day. But it really still gave me the confidence seeing, I did see one on the bed that day too, mm-hmm. up there that I didn't try to catch because it was a 2-pounder. And it sort of made me think, you know, there's probably a lot of fish gonna be bedding up here. And then last year, just the experience from last year, mm-hmm. that I fished up there sight fishing. I knew exactly where they bedded. I knew what banks they bedded on. Out here on a nothing bank.
I mean, that was in nothing. That was out.
That's crazy. I might should have fished this. Well, no, I shouldn't have fished anywhere different.
No, I was going to say, what you did seemed
But this is
out,
the
okay.
same deal. I mean, you know, mm-hmm. I had to get bites. And I mean, it isn't like every fish I caught was a good one. I mean, the TV show will probably show that final day. I went through a lot of numbers of fish. Now, that was my best day. It wasn't my best weight, but it was my best day fishing by far. I mean, I caught a 11.5-pound bag that day.
It was pretty crazy, too, for me following you. You'd hit, like, say from this point to the back here.
Yeah.
You might catch 9 fish.
Yeah.
It was almost boom, 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 boom.
Well, it was banks that they were spawning on, I'm pretty sure, is exactly what's happening.
And it seemed, when they'd get on those banks, they'd spawn, like, on a bank like this.
Yeah.
When there'd be a piece of wood, like a
layout
or something.
Yeah. And
almost
when the water's clearing up, and we might can see it, we'll be able to see it. I don't know if the camera will. As the water cleared up, you know, you can see a lot. I mean, like I said, I only weighed in one that I sight fish for, but probably 7 of the 20 I weighed in come by pitching to what I seen, a light spot where he was bedded. Just a bedding. It was his bed, but you couldn't really see the fish. One time, what clued me in on that is I pitched over to a light spot and it looked like it was a bed. And I was just sitting there and I hopped it and I seen him roll on it, you know, and he had it. It was a 3-pounder. Mm-hmm. So I really, really paid attention to that the rest of the time after that happened.
Well, she's just hanging out down there. Which?
He came up, I saw him.
Yeah.
Water's too clear. I bet he's not hanging out in there right now.
No.
But if, like last year, them fish were really in these log jams, and I think that's more post. There's a bed right there. There's a good one.
Ooh. Oh, yeah.
You may. We'll circle around and I'll catch him. We'll see if he'll bite a jig. He's not real big, but he's a good keeper.
Probably a lot of guys in this tournament that probably would have liked to have him.
Oh, I guarantee it.
Yep.
That's sight fishing with braid. You don't lose too many of them. All right, look. Tell me what he's eating. See the pinchers? Barely can't see them. I can pull it out with pliers.
See
if you
want to
show.
Can get.
That's what that little baita do. I'm gonna pull that pincher out and show the camera if I can get it. Well, he swallowed it. There was a pincher there.
Mm-hmm. One little lone.
But that's a little Beaver Lake special.
Just like that.
And that's you know, you can't fish up this river and win a bunch. I mean, I didn't have a specific spot. You can't win from any specific spot up here for sure. But when they're spawning in this river, they're not going to spawn out there on the river, so they're coming to the pockets. That's the whole thing that set up perfect for me, is the fish were coming to me every day, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They were coming into these pockets getting ready to spawn, and so I had fish coming in, you know. I don't say every day, every pocket, because I didn't run. I probably fished all of my good banks at least twice, you know, but they didn't pay off every time either. There's a better one.
Oh yeah.
Another little special there.
See, you're getting these little stretches.
Right. Buck peeing everywhere.
Oh yeah.
On Canterbury Crawl. Half ounce.
That's a good looking jig too.
Oh yeah. It is a Scott Canterbury flipping jig too. It's pretty nice. All right, let's go look for another pocket. That was pretty fun.
That panned out all right.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Kind of makes you look like you know what you're doing.
I'm telling you, it was pretty neat this week just to have it dialed in that much. Know exactly what's going on.
I mean, yeah.
I knew what was going on and where they were going, and it's not very often that you fish a tournament like I saw it. Not very often that you get to fish a tournament. You know, I mean, every time we go to a tournament, you want to know an idea, man, I think I'm going to catch some there. But it's not very often that you say, man, I know, I pretty much know where they're going and what they're going to do. Yeah, you know, we just pulled into a pocket I hadn't fished all week. You come around the corner and there's another pocket that's got that same, you know, I mean, it's steep on the sides and in the back it's going to flatten out. I mean, you can see it's got a real shallow pocket here and it's steep on the sides. Got lots of wood on the side, so let's go ahead and just hit it. It'll take a few minutes to fish around it, but let's try it and see what's going on.
Thank you, sir.
You know, the scary thing was I had that little lead going into the final day, and Darrell Robinson comes in 15, 20 minutes before weigh-in with 9 pounds and catches a 4.5 and like a 3-pounder in the last 15 minutes and figures out, man, those fish are bedding on the bushes. So, I sort of knew that he had a really good chance to catch a good bag that last day. He figured out that jig bite. You know, we talked about it, and he said, that's crazy. He'd caught all his fish on a Senko up until that point. And he tied that jig on, and it was just, I don't know why the jig bite's so good, unless it's just that they're feeding on those big crawfish. The jig bite's just phenomenal. I mean, we had that charity event today, and
good.
Bohannon went out and fished the jig all day and caught 16
he
pounds
on
them
up,
it. I'm telling you, dude, he said it's just crazy. He couldn't believe how good they're on that jig. I mean, I know he probably threw his crankbaits during the tournament more than anything, but that jig is the deal. That didn't take too long to get a bite in this pocket either.
No.
We just hadn't got the right one yet. I mean, usually on Beaver Lake, 11 or 12 pounds is good, but this week you had to have a 15 or better.
It was pretty phenomenal how many people were catching, you know, I mean, a lot more 2-3 quarter pound fish.
Oh, yeah. The class of fish is really good. And we got here before they spawned. That helped a lot, too.
Exactly.
I mean, I don't even know what the winning weights were, but I think the average fish in a tournament we've ever had before, the best average fish was the year that Thrift won, you know, in February.
Right.
They're real fat. They're, you know, pre-spawn. And, I mean, he caught 20 pounds. He's the first person to ever catch 20 here, I know. So, there's a big weight difference than the times that we've been here, and you catch them on a spook and they're all post-spawn. I mean, it's a lot of fish either way, but you know, the difference of the weight, you add a quarter of a pound to each one and it ends up being, you know, a pound and a half a day or something like that. Mm-hmm. Ends up being 5 or 6 pounds difference at the end of the tournament too.
Now obviously, you know, this pattern you're running here, worked really well this week, and you know, it's a you know, beaver's just a pattern lake anyway, but
right.
This kind of thing, like fishing a jig on wood and banks like this, is that something you've done, you know, other lakes too, like across the South or other parts of the Ozarks?
Oh, definitely across the South. I mean, it hasn't ever set up this way across the Ozarks when I've been in a tournament, but this is the way I grew up fishing at home.
I was going to say, you can do this at home, right?
It's perfect. I mean, this style fits us perfect. I mean, you come to the Coosa River, Neely Henry, somewhere like that, and I mean, it's just a perfect setup for what we like doing. And I felt like I was at home. I'm not fishing with my trolling motor on 20% or nothing.
Right.
I mean, I'm making as many pitches as I can make, And you can tell every bite we've had just about. You don't have to talk them into eating it.
Oh,
I hop it once or twice, and I'm making another pitch. I mean, half the ones I caught this week, and not only the keepers, but half the fish that I caught, hit it on the initial fall anyhow.
Yeah, I know on that final day especially, I'd watch you flip, but like taking photos, it was interesting because basically that first flip, I'd expect to see you load up
yeah.
and crack one.
Some of the fish are really, buried up in the wood, and that's fun. I love it when they're buried up. It makes a little drama when you hook one, but I put my jig in a lot of places that some other people won't do.
Yeah.
I mean, I do. And I've lost a lot of fish doing that, but if you're going to lose him, I mean, at least you had the opportunity.
Yep.
If you don't get that bite, you're not even going to lose him. You're never going to land one of them.
Well, that first fish you caught on the final day, was in a bunch of floating logs and big jam, and it was all wrapped up around it. And
I had one and one later where I just pulled in a pocket, going up through there. I was going to War Eagle, and I went by a pocket as I was on my way to War Eagle, and I looked over there and I said, man, that looks good. I was going to hit waypoint and try to fish it on the way back, and I said, no, I'm going to fish it right now. I did a U-turn sort of and went mm-hmm. in there, and it was just that, I guess, instinct, I was just blessed. I had that urge to go over there. The Lord led me to go that way and pull in there, and I catch a 3.5-pounder back in that log jam, and I got him up in the air flopping. I have to let him back in the water, try to get my line undone. I mean, it causes a lot of drama. Sometimes you lose those fish, but when you land them all, it really pays off. I hadn't seen all this. I mean, I didn't even know this was, but these are the fish I'm catching.
Mm-hmm.
A little further up, it's a little more stained, and it is clearing up. It's clearing up every day. It's cleared up since yesterday some, I'm sure. So, and you probably couldn't see all this with the wind blowing 25 either,
Absolutely.
I mean, that's one key. And I'm sure that helped. Everybody wants to throw a spinner bait when the wind blows and all that. Well, I mean, it helps fish where they can't really get a clear picture of what it is anyhow. No matter if it's a spinner bait or your jig or whatever it is, they don't see you either. I mean, those pitch on that bed, there's a fish on that, and I see him. He might have chased my jig. Daggum, I was like 6 foot from it, and I think it chased my jig. He's back.
Oh, yeah.
He's back.
I think he was sitting on this side a little when I flipped in there, wasn't he?
Yeah, I think he swam off about my jig coming in there, really and truly. Man, it's a fish. It's a full-blown spawn deal. I wasn't sight fishing. I mean, right now we are, but I wasn't.
Well, it's cool that, the water's clearing up, but it's cool
right.
now you can get a real sense, or at least us looking at it,
yeah.
how this is what was happening in the places you were fishing.
I told people, I said, I was just amazed. That second day when I caught 18 pounds, the fish that, dropped eggs in my boat. There's a fish on that bed. Dropped eggs in my boat and everything else. How good those fish were just eating a jig. I mean, usually a jig's not my bait of choice on bed fishing.
Mm-hmm.
But this week it was. That one that I caught off the bed, I seen it, and I didn't even have the rod out. I mean, I had to dig a rod out and put a bait on it and everything to catch it. I mean, I wasn't ready for bed fishing. I had a rod rigged up because I knew it was that time of year. But as far as being prepared for it, I wasn't really that prepared.
There's a bed over there.
Yeah, there's a bed everywhere. Everywhere you look.
There's a couple of them.
That's crazy.
Oh yeah, just started off.
Did it dart off of that?
Yeah, went off to the right there.
Fish everywhere. And the clearer the water, the spookier these fish are gonna get on those beds too. And that really helped me out, I think, more than anything
mm-hmm.
about just being able to cover water. You drop a jig or whatever they're eating in their bed when the water's dirty and they don't see you and they're really in that protective mode,
you know. They just instinctively.
Right, I mean, that's you know, a lot of people sight fishing over the years. I mean, I used to think I was could really do it, and I can still catch them in sight fishing, but knowing exactly where that bed is and making your seeing the bed and being able to see the fish before he sees you and making a cast, making that right cast before they see the boat or anything, you'll catch them a lot of times a lot quicker than you ever will, you know, pulling up and him seeing you, sort of getting spooked like that one is. Yep. He swam off again. There he is back.
We'll try the little pocket slam again.
Give him the pocket slam.
I mean, he's definitely, I think he's definitely catchable. He's hanging out. Sort of skittish, but he's hanging out. And he'll calm down. I mean, it may take a little while. Where I set that. Oh, he ate something.
Yeah, he did.
That's a nice little fish there.
Oh.
Circling pretty quick. Oh, he's good as caught. Just take a minute. You know, my approach is a little different than a lot of people's when it comes to sight fishing. I mean, I use big line sight fishing if I can. And that's always the first thing I do, you know. I mean, if he don't bite it after a little while,
then I'll go down.
Yeah, I mean, but I don't start out with 8-pound line or nothing. A lot of people do, and they're catching.
Yeah, they do.
But I mean, they really do, and they catch them good. But my deal is, when one bites it, I want to put him in the boat. I don't ever. I mean, you break him off, you lose him, anything like that. It's just a. Could cost you the tournament, and I feel more comfortable with the biggest line I can get away with. That's why I start out with it. You know, I mean, that fish isn't really running off.
He's not scared.
I mean, he's circling pretty quick, getting out of there. And
there'd be guys that would look at this setup with Braden and be like, Scott,
oh, yeah.
You're the craziest guy on the planet.
Right. But that fish there, I mean, that last one took me 5 minutes to catch him. All you got to catch is five in a day.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have the right position.
And there were guys down, you know, by the dam in the cleanest water during the tournament that were spending hour and a half on 1 2-pounder, you know, that I'm sure they had to finesse into biting.
Right. See, I don't get into all that. If they're that tough to bite, I don't really want to fish, especially where this lake got as many as in it and they're biting.
Yeah.
I mean, the lake's got lots of fish in it. I mean, that was one thing during practice. Now, that when I spent some time on that lower end the last day, and I seen a lot of fish. And I was, I mean, very close to going down there and starting on a couple of 2.5-pounders, you know. But, I mean, fishing, just going down a bank, I felt like I could, you know, catch 2.5-pounders.
Right.
My first stop, I caught two over two the first day. So, I mean, that was a decision well made not to go start on a 2.5-pounder. That I get down there and catch it, and it takes me 15 minutes to catch it, and then somebody's on the next one I go to, or the next one, and the next one, because there was just boats everywhere. He's right there.
Yeah, he is.
I can't see which way he's facing. He's spinning, you see him?
Yeah.
He just keeps doing circles. He's looking at it right there. Backed up. It's a decent little fish.
Hey.
Braided line, don't fail. I mean, he gets around that tree, I just pull him back.
Rip him right through the sticks.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
Yeah, it's a good fish. But that little pocket slam's a good one for that too, because you can hold such a big hook. It's a good fish though. I don't like this water being this clear for pitching these big jigs, but they're biting it.
Yeah, they don't seem to be arguing with it.
No. I mean, these crawfish, I mean, I need to look in my live well and see if there's any pinchers. I have, I guess, but it's not very often that you see bass spitting up crawfish pinchers 3/4 of an inch long, just a pincher.
That's a big crawfish.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's why, I mean, I went to the biggest jig, big claws and everything, you know, toward the end of that second day, I started seeing some of those crawfish down in their throat. You know, I didn't catch many at all pitching the stuff that was 10 or 15 feet off the bank. As soon as I said that,
there's a big one.
As soon as I said that. It ain't real big, but it's a good little fish.
That's a good one.
You just got to go through a lot of them and get, you know, 3-pounders. I mean, I had 12 something the first day, 12, 14.
Yep.
5 of them's 12 pounds, you know, I mean. As soon as I complained about something and catch one.
That's when you know things are going your way.
Yeah. Early the second day, I can't remember how many fish I had. It's the day I had 18.4, whatever I had the second day. I had one of the best part. I mean, just we had a good time. I had a couple of fish, and I was pitching that compact jig. We fished down a little rocky bank and got right to the last rock, I mean, and I said, dude, I said, we got to go to the creek. That's my last pitch. And I went, there's a bite. Boom! And it was a 4 1/4, I said. You know it's right now.
Yep.
Last pitch, I said. And I said, well, we'll make a few more. So I fished another 50 yards and didn't get a bite. Should have been my last pitch.
Should have ended on a high note.
Yeah. I think I was like the reason I won the tournament. I mean, not the only reason, you know, but one thing I did is I figured that bite out. I mean, everybody that's going out now can do the exact same thing and catch. I mean, they're killing them. But I figured that bite out before everybody else did. I mean, last week the fish were on a wiggle wart.
Yep.
And on, you know, people were catching them square belling. And, you know, when we got here on Sunday, I think Andy Morgan said he had well over 20. One of those great big bags. He said biggest bag he ever had at Beaver. And, you know, just going down, throwing a wiggle wart and a spinnerbait in the wind and fishing the conditions that day.
Right.
And that's one thing that I didn't even do. I mean, I took Maurice Cobb practices with me. And I told him, I said, you're probably going to draw somebody to go down this lake and throw a wiggle wart if you're fishing with somebody today. I said, but you look at our forecast. We don't have these conditions in a tournament and I'm not going to fish. I said, I'm going to try to fish what conditions we're going to be faced with in a tournament. That's what I did. That's my whole practice.
Because there were a lot of guys getting hung up on that.
Oh, I know.
We had a lot of wind during the tournament too, but we had...
Right, but the fish had already... Once they made their mind up to head to the bank, that bite is dying quick.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's not dead. I mean, nothing's dead. You can run around with anything and catch some fish on Beaver because there's so many here. But you got to be on what's happening and what's coming to you. I've never been on a tournament. Say, everybody's sight fishing and everything, and I know some tournaments have been won by Mark Rose and Randy Haynes, tournaments where everybody's up on the bank beating it to death, and he's got them fish just feeding to him.
Right.
You know, he catches... He's not killing them like you do on a summertime tournament, but ones he catches are big ones and they're coming to him. And that's the way it felt this week. And there was other guys catching them really good, but it felt like my pattern got stronger every day.
Yeah.
I mean, especially the section of lake I was fishing. I mean, when I practiced up there, I mean, I struggled. But when it got, when I got back up there during the tournament, it got better and better every day.
Well, Scott, we're about... You know, end of this pocket here, we fished several today. You know, caught a lot of fish.
Yeah.
You showed, that jig bite is on fire right now on the Ozarks.
It really is, you know, I mean, It's unbelievable. It's the best I've ever seen it up here.
Just the sheer volume of fish up was pretty cool. It was great hanging with you, you know, letting you join us in the boat, or letting us join you in the boat.
Anytime.
And I mean, I couldn't have asked for a better guy to win a tournament, I gotta say. And the way you did it was super cool. And the tips you have for people,
yeah,
is really gonna help them out.
I hope so. You know, that's part of it. You know, we do this for a living, and you know, we want to get everybody involved in the outdoors, and people out here, we want them to have a good time. And if you're catching fish, you're having a really good time.
Well, I hope everyone learned a little something from this. Quaker State Pro, Scott Canterbury, congratulations again.
I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Let's roll.
That's it.
Let's go home.
Do it. That wasn't bad at all.